Hi, thanks for letting me speak with you today. My job at Rubin Observatory has been to design activities for the classroom that will get the data from our telescope into the hands of teachers and students. And so today what I'd like to do is share a couple ideas that we've been trying to keep in mind as we've been designing and testing these activities. Something that we've thought a lot about is that often data access is difficult to do. And we want to make this as user-friendly as possible for the widest audience possible. Rubin Observatory is now under construction in Chile, and we hope to begin operations in early 2024. The telescope and camera will take images of very large areas of sky. At the right, you can see the size of the image compared to the full moon. The entire sky visible from our location will be imaged every 3 to 4 days for a period of 10 years. This will allow us to make deep images over time as the images are added together. Our survey is sometimes referred to as a wide, fast, deep survey for that reason. But we'd like to think of the audience we serve as wide, fast, and deep too. Wide meaning that we would like to serve a diverse audience, and fast meaning that we'd like students and teachers to be able to access and use and understand our data quickly without a lot of preparation. And finally, deep, that they leave with a deep understanding of what it is that they were trying to learn. Our audience primarily is the United States and Chile. All of our activities will be available in Spanish and in English. And one of the things we decided early on is that we wanted to design for the most students and not just a few. We recognize the challenges of most teachers. They have limited time to prepare and teach lessons. Challenges in their technology or infrastructure within the classroom or school, and sometimes at the pre-college level, some teachers have a limited background in astronomy, so they don't really feel confident about teaching it. Students in a typical classroom have a diverse range of skills. A lot of them don't feel confident in being able to do math or science. Some students have special needs. So how do we make data accessible for all students? Well, typically if somebody is going to use data in their classroom, it involves downloading a set. It often involves learning some kind of specialized query language in order to access the data that they want. And very often involves having some software on the other end to analyze that data, whether it's a specialized program like image processing or just things like spreadsheets and plotting programs. All of this requires a significant amount of time for the teacher and the student in order to just get ready to use the data. We would like to make it a lot easier, where data access is in the cloud, nothing to download, no firewalls to worry about. All you would need to do is use any modern browser and the internet, and you should be able to get going with exploring data immediately. One of the things we've done for all of our investigations is embed all of the tools that the students need in the investigation itself. So here's an example of a color imaging tool that we've created where nothing is necessary to do outside of using this tool. We also try to keep all of the diagrams and plots of data as simple and clear as possible. On the left, you see a very attractive and well done plot from a scientific paper. It's on supernova light curves, but there's a lot of busyness to that plot. On the right, you see a sample light curve that we have created from our investigation. We're only giving the students information that they need to know. We also have curated our data somewhat to support the learning outcomes. You all know that real data is messy, and oftentimes there are complications that confuse what the general trend of the data might be. So here's an example of a redness versus distance plot where we've intentionally cut off the distance around 14 gigalight years because after that point, that trend becomes less obvious. We also have created computational tools that are built into the investigations themselves so that students don't need to spend time on arithmetic. In this example of a traditional Hubble plot, which many of you may have done before, with students. The data is plotted on the graph, and the slope of the Hubble constant is auto-calculated so that students don't have to do the arithmetic to figure out what the slope is, but rather they can spend more time thinking about what a change in slope might mean. We also like to use multiple types of representations for data. So in this example, you can see a histogram on the left, which is a numerical or quantitative way to describe data. But also on the right, we have an orbit visualizer, which is a more spatial way to look at data. So we hope by combining multiple types of representations and tools that students can use, that will help them build a very, very clear and strong conceptual model of what their data set looks like. We also have created tools to confront some of the common student misconceptions that they may have. So in this particular tool, in Hubble's plot, we let students go to different galaxies to see how the Hubble plot might change or not change from different places in the universe. And because some students think that lining up galaxies on a Hubble plot means that the galaxies are actually in a straight line, we have a spatial orientation tool on the right that students can manipulate to see that, in fact, these galaxies are not in a straight line in space. We also like to provide guided feedback where possible. Before students are asked to do a task with their data, we like to give them some practice. So on the left, you see an example of students trying to find a supernova in an image. We give them some feedback as they try different locations. On the right, you see an example of students trying to figure out how to fit a light curve to a supernova. Last, we like to provide a sequenced reasoning pathway. Often novice learners don't know how to unpack complex ideas. So a common student misconception is that students can't understand how there can be galaxies in the universe that are more than 13.8 billion light years away, since the universe was started about 13.8 billion years ago. So how do we give them a bridge so that they can kind of go through this reasoning with a sequence of questions? You can see here what we've done is we've broken it down into a couple steps where we've asked the students to reason through some questions that will help them get to the place they want to be. The message I'd like to leave you with today is that making data simple and making simple data tools to work with doesn't lower the degree of intellectual rigor or engagement. Some people might look at it and say, you've made it too cookie cutter. But on the other hand, I would argue that when you remove unnecessary tasks and distractors, and when you provide a sequenced learning pathway for students to reason through complex ideas, you've actually freed more time for them to think about their unique data set, for them to engage in discussion, and for them to build a clear, robust conceptual model. Thank you for this opportunity to speak with you today. I welcome your questions and comments. And you can see, you can contact us at education@lsst.org. Thank you.